Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah. Come on. Well, thank you all for coming. It's really an honor being talking in Madrid. I'm from Madrid, so yeah, but it's my first time I talk here. I've been presenting in data conferences, well, in different parts of the world. I've been really fortunate on that. I learn a lot from other people in this kind of conference, so I kind of feel that is my responsibility to give back a little bit to the community and explain my experience. I started working in kind of the big data area around 4 years ago. I was asked to build the data platform, let's say the modern data platform in Santander, UK, around September 2014. I left everything I was doing and started on my own. Got a few people from the organization to start with me. And this is my last talk as part of Santander because I'm moving on to a new challenge. And I'm leaving behind a team of 140 people that serve pretty much the whole organization, hundreds of analysts, and more than 1,000 people in our Hadoop platform. And so we've moved quickly. We've broken a few things, but nothing major in the last 4 years. And we learned a lot, so I wanted to share with you some of the things that I learned. This is my own personal take of the journey, obviously. It represents what we've done in Santander UK, but it's pretty much my own opinion. So I've worked mainly in three countries in the group, and the three bigger banks in Santander, Spain, Brazil, and the UK. I work in the UK only, okay? So the Santander group right now is a little bit disaggregated. Each country goes on its own. In Spain, obviously, Santander is a really big bank. In the UK, we are the fifth bank in the market, which give us enough size, but also a certain position to present ourselves as challengers. So we want to disrupt dynamics in the market and defend the customer, okay? This is what Santander is all about. Creating value for customers and making customers and companies prosper. That's how we define our purpose. In that journey, we decided around 4 years ago that we wanted to become a different company and transform into a data-driven company and digital organization. Okay, so that's a little bit of what I'm going to talk about. First, I'm going to start with our journey to give you some context of how we've moved. As I said, we've been around 4 years in the data transformation. A bit earlier than that, we started experimenting with new technologies, created an innovation area, and they started testing well, technology that was in the vanguard at the time. And since then, we've embarked also in an agile transformation and what we call a digital transformation. Okay, so lots of transformations kind of happening in parallel, which for me means that the bank realizes that we cannot just change at a normal pace. Okay, a transformation is something that is changing more quickly than you would expect. It's not normal evolution, it's accelerated evolution. And so it creates new challenges. Okay, I'm gonna talk about how it feels like a revolution, okay, and what happens in revolutions. Okay. So around 4 years ago, we started testing Hadoop. It was in the news. It was in the Harvard Business Review magazine. Data scientists are the sexiest jobs of the future century. And so the technology was mature enough. It was open source, but there were also enterprise-graded distributions like Cloudera. So that's what we chose. We started testing it. We saw the potential of it to change significantly the dynamics that we had in the organization around data. And we started testing performance, scalability, things like that. And we decided to embark in, bet in it and start investing in it. And we started doing some analytics projects, okay? The analytics projects that we started doing were quite successful, even though we didn't really have tools on top of the platform. We were doing basically Impala queries, SQL, simple visualizations. But we partner very closely with the business. We partner very closely with people that had the knowledge about the problems that we were trying to tackle. We applied some design thinking. We got into a room, we painted, we were very pragmatic about what we had available to us, and we created value very quickly, and that created a very good showcase for what analytics can achieve. And then a few months later, in July 2015, we were launching in the UK Apple Pay, so we created a real-time streaming application that it goes to the customers, it's customer-facing, it's called Spendlytics, and it gives analytics to the customers. It was a very advanced architecture at the time. It was a Lambda architecture using streaming architecture at the time, Flume and Kafka, using HBase and exposing data to customers and giving it to them, giving the power of the data or the value of the data to the right owners because the data belongs to the customers. That was our understanding at the time. And obviously GDPR has validated that. And it was a very important, it was very well designed, so it became the showcase of what data can do, which is not just analytics. It revolutionizes the way you offer data to customers, what you can do with data, including in the channels that we offer to them. Okay? So from here on, once we demonstrated that technology can be put in production, can be maintained, can be scalable, can be replicated, highly available, and so on, we started opening up for the rest of the organization. Okay, what I call broadening. For the next few months, we started implementing a new operating model in which we were opening up the platform and the data for self-service, which is a very different challenge to implementing data in a closed for a closed area, for a closed analytics team that is very well defined. In an organization like Santander UK, we have 20,000 employees, and we are aiming for everyone to have access to data at the right time, with the right information in their hands. So we ended up finding the most friendly business areas and partnering with them, getting their feedback, and building the foundations for the platform with them. And a lot of it was around data governance, which the previous talk has been about. So definitely finding the right metadata in your organization is going to be key. Putting the security as a first step, as a foundational step. Without security, everything can break down. That was very important at the time, and we continuously reinforcing the foundations. And then we started scaling up. So that's when we started opening up for business to start doing things by themselves. And we had the challenge of growing, well, more than 10 times in the volume of data that we were processing and the projects that we were doing. But obviously, the number of people that we had could not grow 10 times. That is impossible. Basically, the talent is really scarce. So if you guys are doing big data, you are very rare in the market. So ask for more money from your companies. And it's very, we had to be very effective so that we could scale the use of data and the value that the company was creating, keeping the headcount in the team as low as possible. Then we started democratizing. And democratizing for us means as people start using the data by themselves, they need to start giving back to the project, to the platform. So we as people, we have our own tools so that when people are identifying, creating insights, they can publish them and they can be searchable, other people can discover them. And then as they find issues in the data, they can publish them, they can report them, and they can be made available to other people. And they have the rights to use the data, but they also have responsibilities, okay? This is a quite different concept. We call it data citizenship. And it's very difficult to make work. And honestly, we haven't made it work properly in Santander UK yet. Okay, but the goal was to become data-driven. And we haven't got there yet. If you see, I've put kind of faces year after year, and I'm now in the beyond the 48th month of the journey, and we haven't achieved this because this requires a significant cultural change that we haven't been able to make. So data is a big asset. We are using it at scale, but we haven't got to the objective that we had, which was to change how people perceive data and what they do with it. Okay, and that's the next part of the conversation today. So where we are is represented in a few slides. Hopefully this, this is a view of a bank. Okay, so we split our organization in domains, and we are representing here how many data sets we have in each of them. Okay, so these are data sets that typically we bring to the platform every day. Most of them, some of them are parameters, so we bring them weekly or monthly or something like that. And we have more than 4,500 data sets now in the data platform. So that's more data than we had in all the other data warehouses that we had in the past combined. Okay, more data than ever, basically. But people still keep asking for more data because they don't seem to find what they want, curiously. Okay. Around 300 of those data sets are being streamed now, which is a big part of the evolution of the platform, streaming architecture. I'm going to talk about that a little bit. And we have implemented BI on top of a platform, very tightly integrated, MicroStrategy in this case, with very tight security, so we don't need to replicate and we don't have any leaks. More than 500 analysts now working in MicroStrategy and more than 1,000 users on Hadoop. As you have seen, we are serving the data to all our channels now. So the app that I showed before, the online banking, the mobile main application, the branch systems, all of them receive data from the platform, but are also around 1,000 users using it for operational purposes internally. Okay. And we've been trying to explain to the organization in this drive to create a cultural change. I've been trying to explain to the organization what we do in the platform, and it's really hard. I don't know if you have experience with that, but people don't really understand data at all in our organization. So we talk about ingestion, we talk about streaming. Most people don't understand really any of those concepts. Okay, they can hear about it 100 times, but they don't place it in their heads, and they don't. So we ended up talking about these simple verbs. Okay. And well, more or less, this has helped in the conversation with many parts of the business. So we just talk about acquiring data, we store it, we do computation on it, and we exploit it. Okay? Obviously, we manage all of that. We very critically, the data is nothing unless you understand what it means. Right? So understanding the data is a key initiative that we have. And then when we find something of value, we serve it to anyone that wants to consume it. We expose APIs with it, okay? So that's what we call our conceptual architecture. And we open up all of those concepts in smaller verbs, as you can see here. So streaming, obviously here we now talk about ingestion, but we talk about access, monitor, support. And in the exploit part, we talk about transforming and organizing the data in a common model. And we analyze it, we iterate on the data, we create a model, et cetera, okay? And we use this to also show what technologies we use in this next slide. So you can see, on top of the conceptual architecture, you can see the technologies that we use. Most of it is open source based, although we use Cloudera distribution of Hadoop. And we use some components, Kafka, particularly from the Confluent community version. And obviously, we have some products that we bite. So we do use Avinicio for metadata, but also for change data capture and MicroStrategy. And we build our own products in some cases. Right, so we have a whole data platform now that we can use for analytics, we can use for operational reporting, we can use for regulatory reporting, we use it for regulatory reporting, we use it to serve data to our channels, okay? So, and now the next stage is to move in the middle, to move to cloud. So we are already implemented, and I'm gonna show you now the streaming architecture in a private cloud model using Docker and Kubernetes. And the journey in Santander UK is to try to do as much as possible in a cloud paradigm, architectural paradigm. Using Red Hat, by the way. OpenShift, okay? so this is our streaming architecture. We ended on this top corner. We have our APIs that we serve to our channels. built with microservices on top of Apache HBase and Apache Phoenix. And we wanted to do that at a scale, so we ended up buying Ab Initio because it's the most effective change data capture that exists now. So we use Ab Initio to take the data out of our core banking system, which is a mainframe, IBM mainframe. And as things happen in the mainframe, we stream it out of the mainframe, put it in Kafka, create different raw topics for each of the tables that we stream, so around 300 now. And then we transform those streams, we merge topics, and all the processing that we do, instead of doing in Kafka, we do it in OpenShift with Docker, in Red Hat OpenShift with Docker and Kubernetes. So it's all streaming to our private cloud and streaming down again. And then we load it in the different databases. Okay, so we have a polyglot architecture in which different databases are used for different purposes. And we use HBase for real-time access. And we use something called NeoDB, which is a distributed relational database. And it's going to be key for our core banking. And we use Apache Kudu or Cloudera Kudu for streaming analytics. And this makes the backbone of our future core banking. Okay, so the core banking on the left, is a monolithic. So we have channels that contain presentation layer, business logic, application layer, all in the same application. On the right hand side, we are building a microservice reactive architecture using APIs that serve the different channels and that can be reused. Okay, and all of that is based on, well, gradually is adopting a reactive architecture using streaming and with Kafka as the data bus. For analysts, we are implementing what we call data as a service. The point being, if you want to implement self-service and you have hundreds of analysts, let's say we have 500 or so, and you have a single team doing data governance, as we were talking before, or one single team doing data architecture, those things become bottlenecks, right? So you need to remove yourself from the process as a central center of excellence team, remove yourself from the process and make it all automated and as a service, right? So that's the idea. So we have a portal where you can search, starting from the top over there. You have a portal where people are supposed to search first, right? To see if what you are trying to do is already exists. And if it does, you use it. And if it doesn't, it's necessarily what you want, then you are supposed to iterate on it and improve it. If it doesn't exist, then you find the data, right? So that's another portal that we have where we have published all the data that we have. We have documented it with metadata. And now you can search in that portal and find the data and how the data relates, how one data set relates to another. So we built a graph, which is kind of an ontology or a knowledge graph. It doesn't go as far as that, of course. But it starts opening up the data for people to understand it by themselves without asking any expert or anything like that. Assuming you have the data, then you can use it. You can put it together, you can transform it. If you don't have the data, we are building what we call ingestion as a service with my friend Guillermo Almonacid runs. The idea is that if you have the data in a different database that is not in the data lake, but you have the metadata of that data, then automatically you can bring that data into the data lake. Because we have all the knowledge that we need to make the decisions about security, personal information, PII information for GDPR, data architecture, and so on. So then we can bring the data automatically. The user can bring the data automatically without talking to IT. Well, so now we have the data in the data lake. You can put it together in a according to the data model. And we are gradually building the data model of the bank in an open source model. So as projects do create a data structure for a certain part of the bank, we plug it in the common data layer. And you can transform the data, then visualize the data, potentially model the data, and everything that you do, you publish it back so the next person can find it. Okay? And overall, where we are is that data is now considered a critical business capability. Okay, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that in the next section. And this relates as well to the presentation about data governance that we just saw, if you were in this room. And we have defined it. We have defined 12 data capabilities. We define what we do around data in the organization. My team, well, now we have an area called data services in Santander UK, which manage all of this. Well, it's the privacy and information security, which are managed by independent areas. The 10 ones on the left are managed by data services, and basically 6 or 7 of these are managed by my current team. And this helps us organize the maturity of the capabilities in the organization and where the investment needs to be. We put a person responsible for each capability, and each of them work kind of as a separate startup within the organization, in that they have to provide value and provide a service to the rest of the organization and make their customers happy. Okay? So how have we grown to the place where we are today in 4 years? Well, first, we take the business capability, and I kind of say there is part of it that enables learning and parts of it that enables value creation. Okay? So you are going to create value with the data, the process, and the technology, but obviously all of that needs to be operated and informed by people. Okay. So for us to be able to grow the capability, we need to grow both the learning and the value. So starting with the value, what you always hear in these conferences is, well, start small, create value, and so on. Yeah, which is fine, it's true, and it's what you should be doing. Find value, find something that of is useful for your organization. Fix that. Show improvement in that. And someone will advocate for your initiative, and then you can keep resolving more and more problems. Okay? If you don't have enough people, well, find other people to help you that are committed and interested in solving that problem. Okay? If you give them the right tools, the right training, people start solving problems by themselves. That's the whole point of self-service, right? So you keep growing by finding a use case. That use case typically has other uses in other parts of the business, so you can take the same use case and with small changes apply it to several problems. And you keep multiplying like that, almost like a tree that keeps opening up more branches, okay? Except that you need to be careful, because if you have very slim foundations and you keep opening more and more branches in that tree, there is a moment where the tree starts shaking because it's not strong enough, okay? So as you grow, you need to continuously reinforce the foundations and improve your platform, okay? The other thing is that you need to keep learning, because no matter how effective you are, as you grow to the scale of 20,000 people company with 40 million customers, you are going to end up needing to grow your team. And finding the right skills is really difficult. So this is the model that we use for a data science team, in which we bring together people from 3 different backgrounds, data scientist, software engineer, data domain, and we try to put them together so they learn from each other. If they have enough common knowledge, they can learn from each other. Typically, they don't. Okay, so then they don't. Okay, we've tried this for 2 years and it's really difficult. So now we try training, we try collaboration with universities, we try software to help them, and we try metadata. Metadata tool, so people don't need to have so much knowledge of the data because it's documented. But anyway, the whole point is that you need to keep growing the knowledge of your team. Okay, if you do both things and you manage to do both things, then you can grow by applying this model that we have used somehow, which is mitosis. If you have enough, think about a cell, you know, in biology. If you have enough sun and enough food, then that cell opens up in two. There's enough cross-pollination, so it splits in two, and then we can put one part of the cell in one domain, another part in another domain, and you give them the opportunity to grow, right? So you've taken maybe 6 people, they have learned from each other for 6 months, and now they have enough knowledge to separate in 2 teams of 3, put some 3 new people in those teams, and they go on their separate ways, start creating value in the organization in that way. Okay, so basically, you started with 6 people, now you have 12. because you plugged other people that were already in the organization or that you brought from outside. The other way we've been growing is by thinking about product teams, about creating product teams and thinking about them as startups. So you think about it, you have a capability, as I painted before, the capability has people, they have software, technology, they have data, and they manage some processes, right? So a capability and a product team are very similar concepts. And what we do in a product team is we separate certain people, multifunctional people, we give them a challenge, we give them a value goal, or they define their own value goal, and they try to deliver that value for the organization by themselves. And if they do it well, they create value for the organization, and the demand that comes to them keeps growing, right? As they keep growing, they start identifying, they get feedback from the consumers, from the users of the service, and they keep growing their service and making it better. Until there is a point that there is no more value to be created. In that process of creating value, they may come up with more services and split up in several cells as well, okay? And at the end of the day, the organization ends up being hundreds of small different teams, which obviously creates a challenge of ensuring that all go in the same direction and with the same goals, okay? So scaling agile is a big challenge. Each of these teams should create a successful value proposition, which is not necessarily easy, but we think about it in this way. Obviously, starting with customer value, it needs to be a value for the company as well. We try to be forward-looking and go past existing mindset restrictions into what the future would need and what is the actual customer need, not just what the customers declare, let's say. Think about customer experience. The market is talking about, instead of minimum viable product, they are talking about minimum lovable product or something like that. So you need to add experience to the product so people really feel that the product that you are creating has the value that you aim for. And try to demonstrate value quickly and reduce uncertainty. Ideally, differentiating the company from the rest of the competition. If you do that, you get some successes. And then you try to make sure that the successes are across the whole organization. So you get someone from the top, I don't know, as an executive member, to sponsor your initiative and give you some money, but that's not enough. And if that person leaves the organization, then potentially your initiative is finished. So you need to create a rapport and an advocacy at all levels, ideally in different business areas, the managers of the data intensive teams and the analysts, right? And hopefully you get some feedback from them and you learn from them. And if you have the ability to adapt to what they need, then you can continuously create a product that they value and they are gonna help you in the journey by selling the successes for you. Okay? And then going back to biology, if you do that, then you have the ability to partner with the business. So your team, you can put some engineers from your team in a product team, and maybe in the first stage of that product team, you need to put 3 or 4 engineers. But then as the business users, if they are technology savvy, they start learning from your engineers, then you can start removing engineers and dedicating them to something else until the product team is independent and or they have kept one of your engineers maybe. And you can multiply the number of product teams where you put people by partnering with the other areas of the organization, which is basically what we aim for. And we have somewhat achieved, although not to the scale that we would like, okay? Because there are challenges. The first challenge I already mentioned, you create quick value, but sometimes you grow too quickly, and then your platform is not as robust as you would like. So you need to be wary about that, and always trying to make it as robust as possible, almost I would say also as simple as possible, because we tend to think about improving the platform by adding more complexity. And in many cases, the best solution is to remove complexity and make it simpler. Okay. Technology is evolving really quickly. So if you are looking for a tool and you don't make a decision in a year, likelihood is the next year there's going to be another tool that is better than the one you thought you were going to get. You need to be conscious that you start using, you start using Spark, and maybe in a few years you're going to need a different tool. So almost you need to be ready for that and make the organization ready for that, because there is going to be investment in the people are going to feel that you are wasting money by investing in something that maybe a few years later you need to invest in something in the same space, but that is much, much better. And obviously, I think it's really important to be always looking at what the industry is doing, coming to these events, looking at the Apache community and other open source communities, and trying to experiment with the tools that are coming out so you can select the best for you. Okay. One key aspect for me is the people, right? So it's really difficult to find good people, and you can have the best technology and whatever, but if you don't have the right people, nothing matters much. So it's really complicated to keep growing and creating value quickly, and keeping people kind of in a peaceful state. Okay, I kind of joke that we've been running for 4 years in sprints, right? So you imagine Usain Bolt running a sprint of 100 meters, or you imagine Mo Salah running a marathon, but you don't imagine Usain Bolt running sprinting for 40 kilometers, right? And sometimes we are trying to do that, and the team gets burned, and they lose, and you lose them. So this is a very important balance between working intensely, but then having some break, or working in a certain in a special project that gives you more, more adrenaline maybe, but then working in another project that is more, well, lower pace. Okay. You can have the best engineers in the world, but everyone ends up cracking under pressure if you apply too much. Okay. And then, as I said before, this is a transformation on top of another transformation on top of another transformation. So really, it's a revolution, and in a revolution, there are people that are going to suffer. There is going to be conflict. Sometimes you want to avoid it, but sometimes you need to seek it, because you are not going to do it. I mean, there are very few revolutions that have happened without conflict, right? There are going to be people kind of at the top that are not needed anymore. People at the bottom, they don't have the right skills, and they are not going to get the right skills. And the people that are driving the revolution, well, you have been in the forefront of the revolution, and sometimes you get shot, I'm joking, of course, metaphorically shot, and you also leave the organization, right? Because when you are driving the transformation, you also get burned in the process, right? So not everyone should survive it. There are people, if this is a real transformation, you are very young people, or most of you, but so maybe you're not going to suffer it, but maybe you suffer it in 10 or 20 years. Some people are not going to survive the transformation, okay? And the sooner we realize that, the healthier it's going to be for the whole company, in my opinion. This is personal opinion, okay? And all of it is a cultural change. So it's very good to be creating value, but what are you trying to do? Are you trying to create value, or are you trying to change the company? Or maybe you're trying to change the company through creation of value, definitely, right? But if you're trying to change your company, you need to think about slightly different things, okay? And the last idea for me, this is something I added yesterday because of some people that I keep hearing about, is a few of these comments that you hear in all around, okay? Everything should start with the business. Technology is not important. Big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence are just technologies. I mean, I don't know if you hear these things. I heard some of this in a couple of sessions yesterday. People don't mean exactly this, okay? But this is what they say. Everything should start with the business. It's not everything should start with a business. It's everything should start with the customer needs, okay? That's what they mean. But is the business in your organization tuned to the customer needs? Really? Do they really understand the customer needs? do they need data to understand the customer needs, or they think they do, but they don't, because I don't think they do, right? So not everything starts with the business, everything starts with the customer. Okay, that's different, it's a different thing. Technology is not important. I mean, the seriously, it's not important. Everything is driven by technology, right? I mean, if there are big oil companies, it's because there is an engine that requires oil, that's technology, right? There are companies that are, the internet is technology. I mean, the wheel is technology. It's a misunderstanding of what technology means, right? Technology is not a computer. That's a piece of technology, of course. But technology drives the evolution of the human being. So, of course, technology is important. And in the digital era, data is also very important. So I think what they say is technology is not important. What they mean is it's not sufficient. Well, technology is not sufficient. You can have the best technology and use it for nothing. And if you don't create value, it's not going to help you. Same with data. So, but customer value is also not sufficient. Nothing is sufficient in this world. You have to combine all of these things, have a strategy, add some innovation, differentiate your product, and definitely be efficient. Hopefully you think about the global, the overall good of the society, and create value for your customer, and then maybe you get somewhere. But definitely bring technology and data to your strategy. Try to get that into your organization as much as you can, because that's the only way organizations are going to survive, in my opinion. And that's it. Thank you very much.